All right, let's open the Word of God. You can begin by opening to Matthew 25. Matthew 25. This sermon series is dedicated to encouraging all of us to put first things first, to put back on the front burner of our lives things that are of first importance, things that matter. They can be things that are so ordinary and an old hat, you know, in a sort of way, that we don't give them much thought and maybe need to think about them, pray about them, consider them more. Or there are certain things that we let slide, that we let just kind of go off into the periphery. It's just, they don't matter as much. We need to be dedicated to Christ, all of us, as individuals and as a church. We need to be dedicated to Jesus' church. We have to be dedicated as Christians to this congregation of the Lord's church as well. That's a decision that you make. It's not something you just fall into or just it just happens by accident. That happens when you make a true decision to be dedicated to the head of the church, to the church itself, and to your family here at Waters. We're also learning and have learned that we must be dedicated to the Lord's Day. The Lord's Day is not very special to many. Even those of us that are here, say, on the Lord's Day all the time, it has to be more than just a presence of your body, but a presence of your heart and your soul. This is our life. We are a family. And the way God portrays the family of God is that they are together all the time. They build themselves up. They are constantly together, worshiping and giving and helping and serving. And the Lord's Day is a very special day, the most special day of our entire week. That's why it is the first day of the week. It is first in importance, not just first on a calendar. And so we need to make that day special. And I pray that you will. We also learned last week that one of those first important matters is to understand that we must become godlike and Christlike in our giving, sacrificial giving. Jesus portrays how to give a life, and we also have to give our life and our treasure and our talents and our goods. Whatever we have, we give with the totality of the blessings that God gives us. That has to be of first importance. So those are the examples. That's where we have been. Now today the challenge is going to take one step up in its challenge, in how hard it is to live and maintain. The challenge this morning is to learn to be dedicated to working for our Master. Working for our Master, Jesus Christ. And more than just working for our Master, to consider ourselves as Jesus considers us, and God does too, as a slave. As a slave. That's a harsh word. And it's meant to be shocking, I think. It's meant to portray something. You had something read to you from 1 Corinthians chapter 7 when Mark was reading about and addressing slavery in the first century church. God doesn't condone slavery. He never did, but it was a fact of life. He wanted those who were in bondage, who became Christians, to consider themselves free. The master may own your body, and you may be a slave to another human being, but you are the freed person in Jesus Christ. Likewise, you can be as free as a bird, but when you become a Christian, you have been bought with a price, and you now are a slave. You see, it's simply a mentality that we must maintain, and it takes humility to be that. It takes a removal of pride from our lives to consider Christ our Master, God our Master, and we His slaves. So I want to give you a warning. I tried to do a flashing screen. I didn't know how to put that little thing on PowerPoint. Warning, warning, warning. So there you go. It's audible right now. These words of Jesus today are among the hardest words He has ever uttered. The hardest stuff he has ever said. The language is brutal and shocking, and it's meant to be this way, to get us to think right and to get over ourselves and to give it all to our Master. That's what we're about today. So our text in Matthew 25, 14 through 46, what we find here in parable form, at least in the first part, in parable form, we see a parable about the kingdom of heaven. That's what Jesus talks about more than anything else, matters pertaining to the kingdom of heaven. And in this parable, Jesus is teaching the people who want the kingdom to come and want to be a part of the kingdom. He is teaching them to be ready for the Master's return and what it literally means to be ready. What does it mean to be ready for the Master to come back after He has gone away? The implications are clear, which means they're not really implications. Clear teachings about Jesus our Master, who 2,000 years ago went away, and when it's the right time as far as God is concerned, He will come back. And what does He want to find? What does He want to see? That's what we have to learn. So in this parable, we find that a master went away, and before he went away, he entrusted his business with his slaves. Matthew chapter 25, 14 through 18, let's read. Again, it will be like a man going on a journey who called his servants and entrusted his property to them. To one he gave 5 talents of money, to another 2 talents, and to another 1 talent, each according to his ability. Then he went on his journey. The man who had received the 5 talents went at once and put his money to work and gained 5 more. So also the one with the 2 talents gained 2 more. But the man who had received the 1 talent went off, dug a hole in the ground, and hid his master's money. Now, what is Jesus talking about? I mean, simply the story can speak for itself, obviously. The master left for a while. He gave his slaves the responsibility for carrying on the master's work. We can presume some of the same things they had been doing while the master was there. Now they were going to be responsible on their own. They carried on the master's work. He gave to each of them a talent, which simply means a measure of money or a measure of something of value. But he also gave to them according to their ability. The master knew what their abilities were. He knew what they were good at. He also knew what they were capable of. He knew that they could handle this, or he would not have entrusted his money, his business, to them. So it says something about that relationships. 2 of them, it says, went out and got to work and then showed success in their endeavor of making money for the master. But they are compared to that one man who was given 1 talent and he showed himself to do nothing. He did nothing with it. Now, my friends, this is meant to be a comparison, of course, to the people that were hearing this parable during the time of Jesus' life. But when you read those words, don't ever think it doesn't matter to you and to me. It's talking about us. The comparison is our lives today. Jesus is the Master, our Master. He entrusted us with His work. He gave His work to us. He has given to each of us according to our abilities. And the work is not more than we can handle. The Lord knows what we can do. He knows what we are capable of. And He gives us according to that ability. But here is the challenging part, the part we often forget to emphasize and to catch. We are slaves of Christ. Now, I read from the NIV, mine's a 19, 84 version, so it's an older version. The newer version, I'm not sure what it says. I should have looked that up. When it says, when he called his servants and entrusted the property, it is rendered servants. That is not the rendering. That is not the word in the Greek language that should be said servants in the English language. The word is slave. It is slave. We are doulos. That's how it would have been written. That's how it is written in Koine Greek, the common language of the day in Jesus' time, especially the written language. Slaves. The master called his slaves together. He gave his slaves work to do and the means by which they could accomplish the task, so that when he came back, he can see how they did with what he gave them. We are slaves. Romans chapter 6 and verse 22, Paul wrote this, "You," talking to Christians, "you have been set free from sin and have become slaves to God." That's the right rendering. Slaves to God. "The benefit you reap leads to holiness, and the result is eternal life." God looks at, Jesus looks at, Paul looks at, the Holy Spirit inspired these words so that the Christians would see it the same way, that it is to our benefit to see God and the Son as our master and we as their slaves. It leads to our holiness. There is no holiness and there is no eternal life unless we give our lives completely over to our loving Savior, Master. Wow. You see what I'm saying? How hard these words are? These aren't words for the faint of heart, but it's trying to teach us this important message. I've always been taken with the words of James. James chapter 1 and verse 1, James begins his letter to the churches this way. James, a slave of God and of the Lord Jesus Christ. And if it's true that James is the brother of Jesus, I believe it is. Most scholars do. That he called his brother, my master. I am his slave. Folks, we are in a very not ordinary, unordinary relationship with God. It is not run of the mill. It's not just about religion and about church going and things like that. This gets right down to it. We are slaves of God. It is a blessing to be one. It makes us what we could never make ourselves, holy in the eyes of God. And it results in eternal life when I give my life fully and completely over to Christ, like He fully and completely gave Himself to me. I loved the prayer during Lord's Supper. As we, before we ate the bread, it said we have to eat this bread in view of a servant's heart. Jesus as a servant and we as servants, we eat that bread. Never forget to think of yourself in this way. And so as slaves then, our master expects us to work responsibly, and also to work productively. Now let's continue in Matthew 25. Look at verse 19. Verse 19, "After a long time, the master of those servants returned and settled accounts with them. The man who had received the 5 talents brought the other 5. Master, he said, you entrusted me with 5 talents. See, I have gained 5 more. His master replied, well done, good and faithful." And the word is still slave. "Slave, you have been faithful with a few things. I will put you in charge of many things. Come and share your master's happiness." Then, or the man with the 2 talents also came. "Master," he said, "you entrusted me with 2 talents. See, I have gained 2 more. His master replied, "Well done, good and faithful servant. You have been faithful with a few things. I will put you in charge of many things. Come and share your master's happiness." Then the man who had received the 1 talent came. "Master," he said, "I knew you are a hard man, harvesting where you have not sown and gathering where you have not scattered. So I was afraid and went out and hid your talent in the ground. See, here is what belongs to you." Words of Jesus now. His master replied, "You wicked lazy slave. So you knew that I harvested where I have not sown and gathered where I have not scattered seed? Well, then you should have put my money on deposit with the bankers so that when I return, I would have received it back with interest. Now the words of the master continue. Take the talent from him and give it to the one who has 10 talents. For everyone who has will be given more, and he who has an he will have an abundance. Whoever does not have, even what he has will be taken from him. And throw that worthless servant outside into the darkness, where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Now, generally, I say this after something like that. I didn't write this. I totally agree with it, but I don't like it one little bit, because it's a picture of who we can be when we don't take our master seriously, and when we don't take our servanthood, our life as slaves seriously. But God and the Son are so serious about how we need to be as productive and responsible and obedient servants of the Lord, where we work for the Master because we love Him and we respect Him and we are thankful to Him for what He has done and what He has given. The master came back after a long time, obviously long enough for the slaves to have actually done something with the money they were entrusted with, but he made them give an account of how they worked and what they were doing while the master is away. Do you see the day of judgment picture here? Jesus is so clear. We can get it. We can get it. It's not meant to make you just slump over and just say, oh. It's not meant to do that, although it's probably necessary for some. It's meant for all of us to see the reality of our lives, our life, and our work while the master is away is important. Our life as a slave of Christ is important. The master is coming home, and his work while he is gone is vastly important because he is preparing the place for us to live, Jesus said, John 14. So these things are important. Notice the 5 talents and the 2 talent slave. They doubled the master's money and received the same praise and the same reward. Whether God gives you 5 or gives you 2, even if you have the one bit of commodity, of capital that God invests in your life with your skills and your talents and your abilities, God simply wants to see what you've done with your life. They all get the same reward. Well done, good and faithful servant. But the man who did nothing was called wicked and lazy by his master. And why is that? Because God is mean or Jesus is horrible? No. It's simply because the man didn't even try. He didn't even try. The effort. This is where God does appreciate effort. The man had 1 talent, each given to him according to his ability. You got something to offer. There are things that you can do. You can do this. Here, I'm not going to put very much pressure on you. Let me give you just the one. You can do it. Bring me back 2. You can do it. Can you see God talking to us that way? Barry, listen. You don't got much going for you. So we'll make you a preacher. Next, okay. Chapter 25, verse 31. What is the work of a slave of Christ? What is the work of a slave of Christ? Matthew chapter 25, starting in verse 31. We'll read to the end of the chapter. When the Son of Man comes in His glory. Now before it was the master coming home. Now that metaphor is taken away. Metaphor gone, at least in beginning, okay? The Son of Man is coming. When the Son of Man comes in His glory, and all the angels with Him, He will sit on His throne in heavenly glory. All the nations will be gathered before Him, and He will separate the people one from another, as a shepherd separates the sheep from the goats. He will put the sheep on His right, and the goats on His left. Then the king will say to those on his right, come, you who are blessed by my Father, take your inheritance, the kingdom prepared for you since the creation of the world. For I was hungry, and you gave me something to eat. I was thirsty, and you gave me something to drink. I was a stranger, and you invited me in. I needed clothes, and you clothed me. I was sick, and you looked after me. I was in prison, and you came to visit me. Then the righteous will answer him, Lord, when did we see you hungry and feed you, or thirsty and give you something to drink? When did we see you a stranger and invite you in, or needing clothes and clothe you? When did we see you sick or in prison and go to visit you? When I hear that, it sounds like they're worried. Wait a minute, I never saw that. I never experienced that, but oh, you did. We do. The king will reply, I tell you the truth, whatever you did for one of the least of these brothers of mine, you did for me. Then he will say to those on his left, depart from me, you who are cursed, into the eternal fire, prepared for the devil and his angels. For I was hungry, and you gave me nothing to eat. I was thirsty, and you gave me nothing to drink. I was a stranger, and you did not invite me in. I needed clothes, and you didn't clothe me. I was sick and in prison, and you did not look after me. They will also answer, Lord, when did we see you hungry or thirsty or a stranger or needing clothes or sick or in prison and did not help you? He will reply, I tell you the truth. Whatever you did not do for one of the least of these, you did not do for me. Then they will go away to eternal punishment, but they're righteous to eternal life. Do you believe the words of Jesus, folks? They're hard to hear, are they not? They're meant to move us. They're meant to move hearts, move bodies. Help us to overcome our inhibitions. It's meant to move people to make decisions, to become the slave to the master that gives us eternal life, that will help us and love us and save us, whom we will live with forever. I want you to jump back to chapter 24, verse 45. 24, 45. What does it mean to be ready for the master to come? What it means is being found working for the master when he comes. Who then is the faithful and wise servant whom the master has put in charge of the servants in his household to give them their food at the proper time? It will be good for that servant whose master finds him doing so when he returns. Working in the kingdom, taking care of people, seeing the needs and giving the help as if we were doing it for the Lord. When the Lord comes back, that is what he wants to find his slaves doing when the master comes back from being away. And so Jesus, how many times in just a few chapters? There are many more. The book of Matthew talks about this a lot because it's so important. And so it means to be found working for the master. So when we think of the kind of work that our master expects us to be doing, we often think in terms of evangelism, that would be right, of giving of ourselves and giving of our money, and that would be right, of the worship that we do and keeping the Lord's Day special and holy and beautiful and being in fellowship with one another and being together all the time so that we can grow and be better in our spiritual life because we're better together than when we are apart, all of that. But Jesus also wants to see how his slaves will give love and grace and mercy and help along with all of that. You know what? I may only have the one talent. Some of you have got 5, 10, 15, 20. But it doesn't matter if you have 10 talents or one talent. We can love. We can show mercy. We can be forgiving. We can lead people to the springs of the water of life. We can open the Word and show them Jesus. We can do this. That is what we all can and should do. And if you're not able to do some of these, I think that's probably true in some cases. Some of the things that we've just read and especially doing to Jesus, there might be some things here you cannot do. And if you can't do some of these things because of your life situation, your age, or the shape of your body, or the things that you have to do in other ways with other ministries, fine. But we should always be ready to bless and address the needs of other people. Some of you do the most incredible work when you get on the phone and call, or you stop by the house for a visit, or write the note, or give a few dollars, or lift people up in prayer. To the extent you do it for others, you do that for Jesus Christ, your master, my master, our master. And so Jesus said that when we do all this for people, we do it for Him, our master, our King. That is what God wants to see, what Jesus wants to see. So I told you this would be challenging, right? Now, the reason that this is challenging, folks, is because our master has high expectations for his slaves. And it should be that way. There needs to be high expectations. Our master is so full of love and grace as well, but he expects us to be faithful in our service as slaves. And so our life of service should be lived so that one day, when there are no more days for us, we need to live our life now so that when we face the master and the separation of the sheep and goats occurs, we will hear these words, "Well done, good and faithful servant." That's what we're living for. That's what will change our lives. If we can pray with you or help you with this, because we're all in the same boat together in this, folks, we'll pray for you. I ask our shepherds to keep praying for all of us to be this type of person. And if you're not in Christ yet, if you've never had your sins washed away in that simple biblical Acts 2 way, today's your day, because you become a slave of Christ when you have your life taken away in baptism, only to give it back to Christ as a slave. And so that's where we begin. So if we can help you in any way, please feel free to come forward as we stand and sing.